こんにちは。
スクリプト通りだと新さんから始まるということで、よろしくお願いいたします。
こんにちは。会社 TWO の新久保です。
少し英語でテスト。
本当にありがとうございます。したことがない、体験したことがなかったことがない、こういうはい、
少しテストをする感があります。
させていただきました。
I cannot hear anything.
Okay, the translation is kicking in right now. This is for the test purpose. We're going to translate what Shin-san just said. Just to recap, my name is Jun Shin-ho as a CEWO of LINE. Thank you so much for joining our event despite your busy schedule. Now,
さて、世界中の誰もが経験したことがないなかったこの COVID-19 の脅威において、LINE がどのようなアクションを取ったのか、稲垣よりお話しさせていただきました。通訳さん、僕はずっと食べますか。はい。私は去年 LINE カンファレンスで、LINE はメッセンジャーを超えて、オンラインの世界とオフラインの世界を融合させ、24時間305日生活をサポートするライフオンラインを実現を目指し、私たちのライフスタイルにイノベーションを起こしていくと発表しました。この COVID-19 を通じて、まさにその私たちの進化が問われることになりました。東日本大震災をきっかけに誕生し、コミュニケーションインフラとして成長して、日本において8400万のユーザーに利用していただき、COVID-19 を通じて、通してさまざまな施策を行っていましたが、まだまだやりきると言える段階ではないと思います。世界ではテクノロジーを使って、接触追跡や AI により感染症診断などのさまざまな施策がアクセント施策とアクションが生まれました。その中で台湾のスピード感のある対応や卓越したリーダーシップは世界にもトップクラスでした。本日はテクノロジーを持ってさまざまな課題を解決し、国民を救った台湾デジタル大臣のオードリー・タンさんをお招きして、ニューノーマルの中で私たちはテクノロジーをどうして向かい合い、どう生かせていくかについてお話しできればと思います。ここからはモデレーターとしてジャーナリストの井上さんが入っていただき、進行をお願いできればと思います。井上さん、よろしくお願いします。
はい、よろしくお願いいたします。はい。はい、はい。はい、こんにちは、井上です。よろしくお願いいたします。ちょっと、簡単な自己紹介をさせてください。私は約20年ぐらい、1999年から、記者をやっておりまして、主に、IT 業界、ネット業界のこの、ドラスティックなイノベーションというものを、ウォッチしてきました。日経 BP 社という、出版社と日経新聞社という新聞社、その2つで、記者をしておったんですが、2年前に、会社を、退社しまして、新しい挑戦を、私自身も今、やっているところです。で、オードリーさんの
I'm not hearing anything from the interpreter, by the way.
Just a moment.
Good afternoon, Ms. Audrey. Can you hear me now? Yes, thank you very much.
Yes, thank you.
And sorry for kept you waiting. So my name is Inoue, and I am the editor, and I have been working in this IT industry. And I used to be editor for Nikkei BP and Nikkei Shimbun, and I'm a freelance writer right now.
今日はオードリーさんのご活躍はずっと、尊敬して見ておりました。画面を通じてお会いできて光栄です。よろしくお願いいたします。
So I have high respect on Ms. Audrey, and it's very nice to meet you today. So Mr. Shin, over to you.
Okay. 僕もオードリーさん、今日言葉にいただきありがとうございます。お会いできて僕も大変嬉しく感じております。オードリーさんはCOVID-19による困難の中でテクノロジーを生かし、強力なリーダーシップをスピードに持って人々を困難から救い、この、比較もできないぐらいに、貢献してきたと思われます。本日はオードリーさんとニューノーマルにおけるテクノロジーとイノベーションで企業と行政というそれぞれの立場から一緒にお話しできればと思っています。
So, Ms. Audrey, it's very great to have you here at Line Day today. And I have been very much interested in meeting with you. And I understand you saved a lot of people with the agility and strong leadership amid of this chaos of the COVID-19. And today, with you, new normal technology innovation is a topic that we'd like to talk with you from the viewpoint of the private sector and public sector.
はい、ではまずですね、オードリーさんの方に、台湾におけるコロナ禍 COVID-19 の施策について、簡単にお話をしていただければと思います。すでに日本でも、マスクマップの話や、チャットボットの話、結構台湾が先進的だったという話はかなり伝わっています。改めてオードリーさんの方から、その辺のサマリーを教えていただければと思います。
So, Ms. Audrey, we'd like to hear from you about the initiatives that Taiwan had taken. So, in Japan, your initiative like Mask Map and Chatbot are already prevalent, but we'd like to hear those stories from you directly.
Sure. So, technology indeed was behind the ideas of fast, fair, fun, the three pillars of our response toward the coronavirus.Should I pause after each sentence so you can work?
No, you don't have to. This is simultaneously translated,
okay.
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay, so on the fast part, last year, last December, it's in the Taiwanese social media, the PTT, where the Dr. Li Wenliang's whistleblowing from Wuhan gets reposted, upvoted, so our medical offices immediately began the health inspection for flights coming in from Wuhan to Taiwan on the 1st of January. That's at least 10 days before anybody else. And I think it's also very important for technology to deploy in advance of the citizens' fear, uncertainty, and doubt. So we set up live streaming press conferences and a central epidemic command center that broadcasts every day and a toll-free number 1922 that anybody can call to get their questions answered. And we did that in January, even before we have the first locally confirmed case. That's because we've been making yearly drills since 2003, since SARS happened last time. So this time in SARS 2.0, not only we have the communication technologies ready, but also the mask production. The mask production in Taiwan, which used to be less than 2 million medical masks a day, has grown to be more than 20 million masks a day in a few short months. And our main work is to distribute those masks fairly as we're ramping up the production. And people in Tainan, specifically Howard Wu and Finjian Qiang made this kind of medical mask map so that people can initially report whether the store near them still have masks or has run out of masks. And I brought this idea into our cabinet level mask meeting so that we work with pharmacists who are very professional and trusted by the community to publish their working schedule, their availability in real time as open data, updated every 30 seconds. And because of this, people queuing in line using their national health insurance card, which covers more than 99.99% of citizens and also residents, can swipe their IC card. Nowadays, they can get 9 medical masks per 2 weeks, or 10 if they are a child. And when I'm queuing in line, the person before me, when they collect the mask, I can just refresh the map on my phone and actually see the number decrease by 9 or 10. And this is important because this makes sure that the government trusts the people with open data and people can participate in the accountability. It's like a distributed ledger. And people don't necessarily have to use a map. They can use a chatbot. One of the most popular chatbots online is by our Center for Disease Control. And on the first week in February, it gained millions of followers so that people, instead of navigating a map, which may be difficult for the elderly, they can just use LINE's built-in positioning feature to share a rough idea of where they are without disclosing their very specific GPS location. And then the chatbot will navigate them to the nearby pharmacy that still have medical masks. So altogether, we ensured more than 95% of Taiwanese population have access to this IC card-based mask rationing supply with the power of maps and chatbots.
なるほど。あの、まあ、今 LINE という、お話も出ました。チャットボットで LINE が台湾でよく使われているというお話もありましたが、あのこのシステムですよね、の構築あるいは、まあ、その展開においてオードリーさんというのはパブリックセクターの立場だと思うんですけども、台湾 の, その民間企業の協力とか、あるいはその民間企業の貢献について、この辺どのぐらいこう寄与されたのか、どういう連携があったのか、簡単に教えていただけますでしょうか。
Thank you, Audrey-san. So basically, we already know that how LINE chatbots been actively used in Taiwanese region. And also, the question is that from your perspective as a public sector, how much of a collaboration happening between the public sector and the private sector in terms of addressing the system development and deploying the systems? So can you talk a little bit more about the collaboration between the public sector and the private sector?
Definitely. For example, when we made the decision that the quarantine at the border must be our main strategy instead of a lockdown, Taiwan has never done a lockdown in this time because we did a lockdown back in the SARS days and it was very traumatic, so nobody want to go to the lockdown anymore. And so we made sure that people who return to Taiwan have to stay 14 days in quarantine. And the people who don't have their own bathroom and so on for a safe quarantining really need a safe place to stay. So the private sector, the professional hotels, especially the high-end hotels that primarily served international travelers, volunteered to join the quarantine hotel program so that the people can stay in a very polished place, feeling very good about the life quality. And so they will stay for the full 14 days in a kind of like vacation. And we even pay them a small stipend, like $33 per day. And so that's business sector participation from the hotel chain owners. But of course, technology companies have also been volunteering, like the HTC in its AI team DeepQ partnered with LINE on a bot for home quarantining. And so if they quarantine at their home, it's very important for us to keep calling them to check their mental health, to check their temperatures, to check that they're feeling okay, that they're not feeling so lonely that they have to break the quarantine. And initially, it took a lot of the time from the local household managers and even police. Because we worked with HTC and LINE on a chatbot that specifically cared about home quarantined people, in a very short time frame, like just a month or so, it got developed and deployed in April. And in May, a survey shows that the approval rate of people working with that assistive intelligence, AI kind of caretaker, is 95% or 96%, and it's a very high number. So it not only saved time for the household managers so that they can have a good night's sleep, but also that the people who are in home quarantine feel much more safe, because anytime in the night they can talk to the chatbot who will answer their questions and so on. So they will stay safer in their mind and therefore less likely to break the home quarantine. This is very nice use of a chatbot technology.
なるほど。IT 面だけじゃなくて本当にそのメンタルケアも含めてこう全体として官民一体のその一体感というものが台湾であったということが非常によく伝わってきました。
Your story really told us how a holistic approach you have taken between the private sector and also the government sector to care not only from the technical perspective but also to care for the mental health of the individuals.
一方で LINE の方なんですけども、こちらもこう日本ではやはり最大のまあコミュニケーションツール、社会インフラとなっている状況で、まあ厚生労働省と連携してアンケートを取るなどのですね、まあ様々なそのコロナ禍での施策というものがありました。この辺新さん全体をですね通じて、まあここまでの段階でどのようなその感想とかあるいは課題感みたいのを持ちましたでしょうか。
まず今のオードリーさんのお話をお聞きにして、まさにこの全体的な対策が今国と民間の連携でうまくいって、特にこのスピード感がものすごく大事な、まさに家族の精神で我々社内で企画会議して早めに何かこの問題をそんなように解決するかっていう流れとほぼ同じ感じの流れだと思うんですけど、それが単なるシップじゃなくて政府民間この全国民の協力の上でその自作が行ったことは興味深く、我々も興味深く今見ていますし感動しています。
So your holistic approach involving the nation and the public sector and private sector with the speed is very impressive, and it sounded like company meeting, when we have the planning meeting internally, you had that agility. So the involvement of public sector, private sector and the citizens are very important.
特に LINE がこのコロナ禍で中で行った施策としては、例えばさっき井上さんがおっしゃったような、全国的に今この、水田さん国民が、どの健康状態になるかっていうところを調査する必要が、厚生省からの要請もあったと思うんですけど、それをやっぱり LINE が参加して、全国調査っていう形で行ったり、自治体と連携してさっきおっしゃった大鳥さんがおっしゃったようなパーソナルなケアのところも一緒に取り組んでおりました。特に LINE はコミュニケーションツールなので、コミュニケーションを強化するためには例えば病院に行かない今状況なので、オンライン健康相談を行ったりとか、今みたいにビデオツアーを強化したりとかする施策も行ってきました。
So, as line, in the middle of COVID-19, as Mr. Inoue discussed earlier, we had introduced some initiatives. And in order to express our infrastructure value, we had health check of the citizens, which was a request from the health authority in Japan. And also, we provided some personal care support aligned with the municipalities. And as a platform of the communication, we offered some health consultant or video chat functionalities, and people were not able to go to hospitals, so we offered some functionalities to have the diagnosis over the video.
特にないの場合は、この誕生の背景ってなったのが、東日本大震災をきっかけに、会社がなんとかちょっと社会に貢献したいっていう思いで、なんかってことなのがラインだったんですけど。なので、このCOVID-19 のコロナ禍の中で、ラインがどんなふうにも社会貢献できるかについても、社内で結構自主的にいろいろ議論が行っていますけど、その中でやっぱり、民間企業が何か社会貢献するためには、民間企業だけじゃなくて、日頃の常に、今、政府機関とか自治体、団体で、どんなリレーションシップを持って、どんな信頼関係で、どんな活動をしたかによって、結構スピードに応じて、なんかスピードになんか実行できることも可能だったと思います。
So, the reason why LINE was founded was to contribute to the disaster for the East Japan earthquake. And we wanted to contribute in the similar manner to the COVID-19 as well. So, we had many corporate discussions internally. And we need to have the private sector and government relationship or partnership in order to contribute in full manner. So we have to have the relationship, such a relationship, and also the trusted relationship, and we have to work with speed.
特にこの、未曾有の前例のないこのコロナ禍の中には、ちょっと何か事例があるわけでもないので、今台湾で行ったようなマスクマップも良い事例だと思うんですけれど、今、既存の発想とかにとらわずに、新しい今、課題をどんなふうに、なんか政府と民間の企業が一緒に連携して、解決していくかっていう、協力関係がものすごく重要だというふうに考えております。
So because we are in unprecedented period due to this COVID-19, we do not have any precedent knowledge within ourselves. So your initiative, such a mask map, is a new idea. So we have to have innovative ideas to solve these issues. So in order to do so, we have to have a good relationship between the public and private sectors.
Hi. ありがとうございます。ちょっとイントロダクションで結構尺を時間を取ってしまいました。でここからちょっと本題というかですね、今日まず一つ目、重要な議題をまずオードリーさんにお聞きしたいんですけども。
So we have taken some time to go through the introduction portion, but let's go into the main topic from here. The first question will be addressed to you, Audrey-san. どうぞ。
民間企業というのはですね、このコロナ禍で今後どう貢献していくべきか。オードリーさんからすれば何を民間企業に今後期待しているのか、LINE も含めてですね、オードリーさんの所感を、まずお伺いしたいと思います。
オードリーさん、if you could kindly share your view of what's the expectation from you towards private sector, including LINE, against this COVID-19 situation?
In Taiwan, because we don't have that much of a biological pandemic risk,our main expectation is around the infodemic, because people feel very stressed and anxious. Conspiracy theories, rumors, because in LINE, it's very easy to click share, to share to group of people, even before you check whether that idea is actually based in reality or not. If it's on the public social media like Twitter, at least one can flag something as spam.Very easily because many people see it. But LINE is entirely end-to-end encrypted. That is to say, other than the group's recipient, nobody knows that this rumor is making rounds. And that does create problem, for example, on panic buying of instant noodles, because there was a rumor that says instant noodles are going to run out. And after that, there's another rumor online says the instant noodles are very bad to your health. After you eat one cup, it will take 32 days to detox and things like that. My expectation is that LINE can work with the fact-checking partners, and they have indeed done so. Why would I know the instant noodle has been making rounds again? Because LINE Taiwan has built as their corporate social responsibility, showing the trending rumors and whether they're debunked by fact checkers or not. And all in all, there's more than 200K people reported a unique number of 40K different rumors as tracked by this dashboard. And so I think this is a really good contribution from LINE without sacrificing the freedom of speech and the secrecy of communication. LINE has introduced a way for people to report something as spun, as easy as they would share. It's the same long click, but if you click instead of share, you click flag as spam, it gets sent to the fact checkers. And I think this is very important. And we look forward to work with not only LINE, but also Trend Micro, which is an antivirus company in Taiwan that has introduced a Dr. Message, which is a cute dog that can use AI to scan for incoming like advertisements that are actually fake, video that are actually fake, and so on. So you can forward to the robot dog, and the robot dog will do a computer vision check and get back to you whether this is a doctored photo or whether this is something that is actually true. So I think LINE, working closely with the fact checker community on one side and the antivirus community on the other side, I think is important in keeping the infodemic from spreading.
So Shin-san, could you give us a comment?
まず我々、LINE 台湾チームからこの、まあ、ライブにはフェイクディスペクトデックというふうに呼んだんですけど、結構 LINE は、まあ、ちょっとこれが一番課題で我々は復元しないといけないというところで、今日、ウドリさんからちょっとお話しいただいて、まあ、自分自身もこのプロジェクトについて
So, sorry, his voice was quite intermittent, but this fact check is very important, and I think we need to contribute with a similar manner like Taiwan, but through, you referred to some LINE function, and I felt quite honored.
それと、このやっぱりまあ、特にコミュニケーションインプラとか、まあ、社会インプラとして、まあ、サービスはやっぱり、まあ、今時期こそ、まあ、手間に振り回されないように、まあ、正しい情報をどんなように伝達するかが、まあ、大事な、まあ、一つの課題だと思うんですけど、まあ、LINE も LINE ニュースとか、まあ、台湾だったら LINE Today をニュースというサービスを、まあ、通じて、まあ、どんなように、まあ、迅速にでも正しい情報をユーザーに伝達できるかについて、まあ、重要な課題 としては思っております。
So we have the community and social infrastructure, but we have to distribute the right or accurate information in agile manner to the citizens. And LINE provides LINE news. Probably in Taiwan we have LINE today, and we have to disseminate the accurate information in swift manner.
Hi.この LINE の、はい、もう一つの本質の機能としてやっぱりコミュニケーション機能はあると思うんですけど、まあ、特にこのコロナ禍の中には、まあ、会社に行けない、学校に行けない、まあ、ちょっと怖くて病院まで、まあ、病気になって病院に行くことが怖いっていう課題を持って、まあ、コミュニケーション自体がちょっと分断される課題を持っていますので、それをどんなふうに乗り越えるかが、まあ、LINE 社としての一つの課題になっております。
So we do have the communication functionality as LINE, but currently people are not able to go to the office or school or hospitals, and they are kind of divided right now. So as LINE, we would like to contribute to go over this period.
はい、 やはり今後の、まあ、課題としてですね、そのオードリーさんがおっしゃったような情報の信憑性をいかにその担保していくのか、ファクトをどうチェックしていくのかというところにおいてですね、オードリーさんが AI の活躍についてどのように思われているのか、まあ、ファクトチェックだけではなくって、 AI とこの社会全体がどうこう融合していくべきなのか、この辺でお考えがあれば、一言いただきたいと思います、オードリーさんに。
So the accuracy and fact check seems to be a very important thing that we have to assure to the citizens. And I'd like to ask you about the AI and what kind of fusion is necessary with this AI and the society.
In my mind, AI stands for assistive intelligence. That is to say, they are assistants to the human society.And as you would expect to any of your assistants, two things are important. First is value alignment. The assistant need to act in your best interest. If you care about personal data, your AI need to act in a privacy first manner and prove that alignment every time you have a transaction. And that's the second thing. It's mutual accountability, meaning that it has a dutyto make a full explanation of why it's making some action on behalf of you. If your assistant is very dutiful, they will explain to you why they are making such decisions. They will not, for example, ask five other assistants to make their own decisions, but with no way to integrate them into a coherent report. And nobody has the time.To read through the 5 or 25 or 125 siloed reports about why your assistant worked in this way. So, the way to build mutual accountability across silos in a way to explain their action to you to prove the value is aligned, for example, on privacy, that is important. So, alignment and accountability.
No.一方で LINE もですね、AI、まあ、スマートスピーカーはじめ、いろんな研究開発も行っております。陳さん、どのようにこう社会と、これから、AI を使っていこうと考えますか。
Next question is addressed to Shin-san. We understand that LINE is also working on AI technology recently. You're working on smart speaker and you're pushing with the R&D focusing on AI. So how do you want to leverage AI to contribute to the society?
まずは踊りさんがおっしゃったようにちょっとまあ間違いやすいところが AI はテクノロジー観点からちょっと入るとやっぱりこの人間のためにまあユーザーのためにどんなようになんか新しい価値を提供することじゃなくてこの技術がこのテクノロジーがっていう観点で入ると、まあ、結構なんかいろいろ社会問題を起こしたりとかいいとこよりはちょっとまあ弊害が起こりやすいまあ部分だと思いますのでまあ、LINE 社で考える AI はまずどんなふうにユーザーにとって新しい価値を新しい利便性を出すかからやっぱりスタートしないといけないところがまず重要な部分だと思います。
One thing I could say is that if you look at AI from a technical perspective first, then you might see the problem more to the society rather than the benefits that can bring with you. So from LINE's perspective, when we say LINE AI, we want to focus on the new values and new convenience that can be brought into the society through us.
特にまあ技術面としては、まあ、その観点でどんなようにまあなんかまあ AI を通じて我々新しい価値を提供するかによってまあ集中しているんですけど例えばまあコロナ禍によってちょっと行政とかの方でまあこの人手が足りない、まあ、病院で医療機関で人手が足りない課題が持っていると思うんですけど、まあ、例えば我々音声認識とか、まあ、自動応対技術を通じてまあ、例えば、まあ、人を測らなくても、まあ、自動応対する、さっき例えばいろいろ不安になっている人のチャットボットと同じ、まあ、形式だと思うんですけど、まあ、自分の声で、まあ、例えばリテラシーが高くない人とか、まあ、高齢の方も、まあ、コンピューターとか、まあ、スマホをいじれなくても、自分の音声でいろいろ情報を知りたい場合は、まあ、自動応答のチャットボットを利用したりとか。まあ、画像分析によって、まあ、診断につながるとか、まあ、顔認識によって対面しなくても本人確認できたりとか、 ふうにどんなに新しい価値を提供するかについて研究開発を進んでおります。
So our R&D is focusing on providing new value through AI. And from the technical perspective, we can make suggestions such as helping by the medical institutions or government against this COVID-19 situation by providing a voice recognition system or automated response system. Audrey-san, you just gave an example about the chatbot. I think we can take the similar approach there. And it's even for the elders with low literacy towards technology, people who are not very good at leveraging smartphone, they can use their own voice so that they can initiate the chatbot, or we can help assist by using the image diagnostics, or even the person can do the self-check using the technology, using AI.
もう一つのこの AI 中心の LINE の取り込み一つは、この福岡市と一緒に取り組んでいる、スマートシティというプロジェクトがあるんですけど、この行政と民間会社が一緒にキャッシュレスとか AI によって行政手続きの効率化とかいろんな場面で一緒にどんなようにもっと住みやすい環境に作るか、特にこの今回みたいに COVID-19 とかの危機的な状況が起きた際にどのようなスピードに協力しながらもっとスマートなシティを作るかについても、環境に作るかについても今プロジェクトを進んでおります。
Another example I would like to give you with regards to the use of AI within LINE is that we are currently collaborating with Fukuoka City to work on smart city. This is another example of collaboration between private sector and government sector, focusing on cashless, for example. This is to enable and provide a higher efficiency, for example, for the administrative processing, so that we can make sure that the citizens can enjoy more citizen-friendly location, especially right now we're facing COVID-19, so we want to make sure that we can move swiftly so that we can provide a good smart city for the citizens.
こうした取り組みについて、オドリさん、どんな感想をお持ちでしょうか。
So, Audrey-san, what is your impression about Mr. Shin's speak?
Well, I think a smart city is where the citizens become smarter, and a smartphone is when the phone's individual, the human, becomes smarter. If a phone is too smart,at risks of the person gets addicted to the phone and become an appliance to the phone. In the same way, a smart city also has the risk of being too smart and making decisions for the citizen. So the citizen is less inclined to participate in the city's public affairs. And so I think it's great to have smartphones and a smart city, but we always need to be humble as designers so that the citizen themselves can always takea different route and use on the application layer, as we say, different innovations as they want, instead of being locked in to particular solutions to particular problems. I think if LINE keeps consistent of this idea of becoming a platform instead of a vendor lock-in, I think it will unlock and unleash creativity from smarter citizens.
なるほど。今後のことを考えていくとですね、やはりその AI っていうのはですね、ニューノーマルにどういうふうに、対応していくべきなのかどうかという、話にもつながっていくと思います。で、次のちょっと話題に移りたいと思うんですけども、アジアのそのインターネット企業とかですね、テクノロジー企業というのはですね、今後そのニューノーマルと言われている新しいその時代においてどうあるべきなのかという、漠然とした質問なんですけども、あるいはビジョンとしてどんなビジョンを持つのか、ここまで非常に示唆に富む、ヒントをいただいていると思います。つまり人間第一主義というかですね、オードリーさんは非常にその、ヒューマンファーストといいますか、常にその当たり前なんだけども人間を中心に置いて物事を考えると、この辺がちょっとヒントになってくるのかなと思うんですけども。
So when it comes to AI, I think it is very important to consider how to respond with the new normal situation. So, how the Asian internet companies and technology companies need to be in this new normal situation needs to be considered. But I think you were, Audrey-san, you gave us a good vision, with the word human first. It is very natural. It's essential. But from this point of view, Shin-san, what do you think?
まずこの、まあ、さっきおっしゃったような、まあ、ヒューマンファーストとか人間目線で実際にテクノ単なるテクノロジーの進化じゃなくて実際に人間のためユーザーのために、うん、まあ、国民のためにどんなように貢献するかの観点で物事を判断しないと、まあ、いけないかなと思います。まあ、でも、まあ、AI っていうところは単なる技術じゃなくて、まあ、弊社から見るとそれが例えば、まあ、さっき最近よく呼ばれる、まあ、デジタル、まあ、トランスフォーメーションっていう概念があ あると思うんですけど、この DX っていう観点で、まあ、物事を、まあ、オフラインからオンライン化するとかもっと効率化するっていうところの中で、まあ、最終的には、まあ、より効率化の、まあ、頂点に、まあ、あるのがやっぱり AI 技術の基盤だと思いますし、特にこの COVID-19 的な、まあ、危機を見ても今までの常識で対応できないところをスピードに対応するためには、まあ、技術のなんか、まあ、一番重要なところで、まあ、AI 技術が先端的に、まあ、重要化されるかなと思います。
So, your word human first is very important, and we always need to consider what we can contribute to the society and also the human. And from that perspective, as a company, we need to make the decision. And AI should not be just a keyword. And the digital transformation is progressing and making everything from offline to online basis to improve the efficiency. And in order to support this transition, AI platform is going to be very important. And COVID-19 situation, the conventional norm wouldn't work. So we have to respond to this situation with agility, and AI technology would be very important.
その中でもう一個、まあ、強調したいところはやっぱり、まあ、ちょっと考えないといけないところは、まあ、今の AI の動きを見ると、まあ、大手の一部企業がこの主導権を握っていて、まあ、主なテクノロジーとかを、まあ、自分で持っていてちょっと、まあ、特許とかで、まあ、独占される状況だと思うんですけど、まあ、例えば COVID-19 的な、まあ、世界的な危機になってこの技術が公平に使われているかとか、例えば、まあ、アジア各国でこの技術が必要な場面で必要な企業が持っているかの課題もあると思います。なので、まあ、LINE 社としては今一番先端の技術を、まあ、大手の一部の企業だけじゃなくて、まあ、自社で開発したりとかこのアジアのっていう観点で、まあ、今例えば欧米とかの目線じゃなくて、まあ、それが、まあ、正しい一つの世界があるはずじゃないかと思いますので、まあ、多様化してこの、まあ、多様な場面でどんなようにこの技術を実際に社会貢献できるかについて、まあ、LINE 社も、まあ、貢献できればというふうに考えております。
So again about this current AI situation, unfortunately the technology is controlled by a limited number of companies, a certain number of companies. They hold a patent and keep their technologies inside. So in this COVID-19 pandemic situation, the corporations need to unleash those technologies to be able to contribute to the society. And LINE also have the advanced technology, but and we also or internally develop our technologies, but we would like to keep the diversity of this technology to contribute to the human and the world.
はい、ありがとうございます。で、今度はオドリさんの方にも同じ質問をしたいと思います。このニューノーマルと呼ばれる新しい時代において、このアジアのインターネット企業、アジアをリードするテクノロジー企業というものは、どんなビジョンを掲げてこれからやっていけばいいのか、特にGAFA と呼ばれる米国の巨人、日本では、まあ、脅威だという捉え方をしていますが、その GAFA との対比の中でアジアがなすべき役割、ここを考えがあればぜひお聞かせください。
Same question to you, Audrey-san. So against this new normal, how should Asian internet companies, the leading technology companies, should move forward with what kind of vision? In Japan, people say that GAFA, the U.S. giants, are a threat to companies. But what do you think? So how should Asian companies move forward? If you can also kindly give a comparison against the U.S. giants, that will also be appreciated.
Well, I need to first fully disclose that before I'm a digital minister, I work with Apple on AI, on Siri technology for 6 years. And I always have some troubles of Apple being lined up with Google, Amazon, and Facebook, because when I talk about privacy first and about accountability, that's what Apple always prides themselves in that they sell the product, but they do not sell its users, right? And so I think even within GAFA, there are value differences. Now, of course, I'm no longer working with Apple, so I don't say this to praise Apple, but what I mean is that in each country, each country's leading technology companies have a social responsibility to show the society that they are working to reinforce the kind of societal norms that we are reinforcing. For example, in both Japan and Taiwan, when there comes a natural disaster or the pandemic, everybody, regardless of what kind of work they were doing, they can work on the disaster relief together. And this is what we both believe in. And in both Taiwan and Japan, facing with an aging society, instead of saying the elderly should be excluded from the society, we're saying technology should bring elders back to participate even after they retire. Actually, after they retire, they have more time. So if we build good assistive technology, they can contribute to the society even more compared to when they were still working for a salary, and so on. So because of this, I think the more that the technology companies see themselves as assistants to the society's value, the more they will be embraced by the society, so that GAFA have to also change how they operate in our countries to conform to our norms. In Taiwan, radical transparency in politics is an important norm. We occupy the parliament for it, and we ask for all the parliamentarians' campaign donation and expense to be radically transparent, and that's the norm. And faced with the threat of social sanction, Facebook eventually agreed, starting in our presidential election earlier this year, that all the campaign donation and expense through the social media are opened in real time as open data for independent analysis. So nobody will try a dark pattern to discourage people from voting or to spread disinformation. And foreign funding no longer can influence our elections through the advertisement place. But this is because the Taiwanese social media, PTT and so on, first sign on the self-regulation, and they win people's praise. And so Facebook is faced with the choice of either conforming to Taiwanese norm or face social sanction. So it's not for a government to make a law or something, but they will see that a leading technologist in Taiwan agree on a norm. And in order to do business here without getting boycotted by users, they have to conform to this norm. So we have a value setter, a agenda setter's duty as leading technologists in our own countries.
それぞれの国でのそのアジェンダの設定なんですけども、ここまあ、非常に難しいポイントだと思います。で、まさにこの議論の最初の方にあった官民のその協力連携というものが一番大事になってくると思うんですけども、ここでやっぱり日本というのはなかなか官民の協力が苦手な国というふうにされています。台湾のその協力体制というものを非常に羨ましく思う言説が多いという中で、この日本でのですね、官民の協力について何かアドバイスなりですね、ご意見あれば、オードリーさん、ぜひ教えてください。
So when it comes to the setting the agenda, I think it is very difficult by each country. And in order to set the agenda, the public sector and private sector's collaboration is very important. But as probably you know, in Japan, it is very difficult to seek for such collaboration. And we really envy what is happening in Taiwan. So from Taiwan standpoint, could you give us some advice to Japanese public sector and private sector, how they are able to seek for the collaboration?
Well, this is also a new normal for Taiwan. In 2013, people would not believe that such a thing is possible. But we're not telling you to occupy your parliament, which is literally how it happened in Taiwan, for this new normal to happen. But what is important, though, is for people to feel that not only they can join a social movement online, spreading the hashtags and memes and cute cards and things like that, they need to feel that their social sector work is endorsed by a politician to become official overnight. I participated personally on the dashboard to visualize Tokyo metropolitan area's COVID status. And that's a Code for Japan work. It's entirely social sector. It's on GitHub. The people in Taiwan participated in the translation. I also contributed. And when my contribution gets tweeted by your mayor of Tokyo, I was very surprising. But it's also very encouraging for everybody working on that project. And then we have that dashboard being introduced to all the different parts in Japan and became a government public infrastructure that is maintained by the civic technologists. And the civic technologists no longer feel like civic tech, private sector. They feel like they're civil engineers because their work is now used by a majority of population that puts them in the same position as designers of highways and public roads. And only then will they be able then to truly call this a social infrastructure and effect the kind of change that you were pointing to before they think themselves as hobbyists or as private sector people and so on. That would not work. We need to put ourselves into the mindset of a civil engineer that designs bridges and so on.
Hi. ありがとうございます。非常に示唆に富む、アドバイス、情報ありました。これを受けて、シンさん、いかがでしょうか。
Thank you very much. It was a great insight. So, Shin san, what is your opinion?
この、まあ、ニューノーマルっていうところは、やっぱり新しい何かスタンダードが生まれるっていう、まあ、意味も含まれていると思うんですけど、まあ、その中で例えば、まあ、コロナ COVID-19 によって、まあ、強制的な変化もあると思うんですけど、まあ、それにちょっとなんか克服するために対抗するための例えば人々のまあチャレンジ精神がまあニューノーマルを作るまあ一つの背景になると思います。例えば今大谷さんがおっしゃったようないろいろ取り組みの中でまあ僕も新たに感じているのはまあニューノーマルの新しい時代はやっぱり新しい世代がまあ主役にまあなっているかなというふうに思うんですけど、やっぱりまあ社会的な課題とかまあ局面を見るとそれをまあ素直に認めてなんかちょっと何か克服したくならないまあ今タイプと、まあ、でも 今の若い世代は何か不満があったりとか課題意識があったら自分で解決したい、まあ、今のインターネットユーザーは自分で直接参加して何か新しい問題を解決したいっていうところも、まあ、今のニューノーマルという形式の新しい現象の一つだと思いますし、それがまあ全体的にまあ企業じゃなくて社会全体的にまあエントリーシップというかこのまあ新しいまあ問題をまあ直接に自分の手で解決したい、まあ、解決に参加したい、貢献したいっていう、まあ、精神的な面も結構大事になるかなというふうに考えております。
So, as Audrey-san mentioned, new normal is the place where the new standard is going to be born. So, COVID-19 situation is making the rapid change to the society. And in order to go over this period, I think the challenging spirit is very important. And when it comes to this new normal activities, we need to make the new generation or younger generations to be the main players. And those we have to accept the issues as issues and try to overcome these problems. And current younger generations seems to wish to solve their issues by themselves. They wish to participate in such activities. So that, I believe, is going to be the new normal. So the, not only the public sector, but society itself needs to have some kind of entrepreneurship mindset and have everybody participate in activities.
以上ありがとうございました。あのお時間に、そろそろなってしまいます、もっともっといろんなことをお伺いしたかったのですが、最後にですね、オードリーさんから、この日本の、LINE のユーザーもたくさん、 このオードリーさんのメッセージを見ています。日本のユーザーに向けて、何かメッセージがあれば一言お願いします。
Time is almost up. We wish we were able to hear more stories from you, but do you have a last message to the lots of LINE users who are now keenly watching your message? Anything to close off with?
Well, I wish you all a very good local time and live long and prosper. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. シンさん、最後に、オードリーさんの印象や、このセッションの、締めの言葉をお願いいたします。
シンさん、from you, please. Any closing remarks and your impression towards Audrey-san through this discussion as well, please.
今日はオードリーさんのお招きいただき、まあ、貴重な、まあ、いろいろなんか教えが多かったと思います。特に、まあ、国はそれぞれ違うんですけど、やっぱりでも、まあ、もっと先進的な社会に向かいたいという、まあ、国際視野は同じかなと思いますので、今日、まあ、尊敬するオードリーさんと一緒にお話できて、まあ、嬉しいことだと思います、まあ、それと LINE という会社は、まあ、国内の日本だけじゃなくて今台湾とかタイとかにも結構支持を受けて社会インフラとして今活躍しておりますので、まあ、LINE を通じて、まあ、いろんな国で、まあ、交流がもっとなんか促進できる、まあ、一つの材料になればと、もっと声になるかなと思います。今日はありがとうございました。
Thank you very much, Audrey-san. It was such an honor to have you here because I admire you so much and I learned a lot from you today. Even though we're from different countries, I think what we're aiming for, the vision itself seems to be consistent with each other. And one more point, LINE is quite popular, not only in Japan, but also in Thai and Thailand. So we are more serving more like a social infrastructure in those regions as well. So we hope this through this discussion, we can even accelerate this kind of communication with different countries as well. Thank you very much.
Yes, and just one word, the kind of doctor message work in Taiwan, I introduced the LINE bot about the infodemic, fighting the infodemic. That actually is a social innovation started in Taiwan called COFACTS. And I just participated in their online forum. And it's called COFACT.org. And there's also now a Thai version. And so I really thank LINE Thailand for taking a Taiwan model, not only on fighting the pandemic, but also on fighting the infodemic and supporting through the CSR department in Thailand, the same thing as CSR Taiwan has worked with the Taiwan government. And I think that is a great collaboration between our different public and private sectors to empower Thailand's social sector. So the three-sectoral collaboration and across three countries, I think is a very good model going forward. And thank you so much for your contribution.
Thank you.
はい、じゃあ今日はどうもありがとうございました。Thank you very much, オードリーさん。
Very much.
ありがとうございました、シンさん。
ありがとうございました。
ありがとうございました。See you next time.
Bye.
Bye.